I'm Nikhil Singh, and I'm a nephrologist at Yale University studying kidney injury and repair in the laboratory of Dr. Lloyd Cantley. I'm the lead and corresponding author of this paper, and I want, right from the outset, to highlight the efforts of several members of our team, including two extremely gifted medical students, Judith Kliegel and Zach Avigan, who have made immense contributions to this project. A common frustration among clinicians who evaluate patients with acute kidney injury is the dearth of effective therapies for some of the most common causes of AKI, including acute tubular injury. It's increasingly appreciated that, despite several excellent animal models of tubular injury, we need to better define the biology of the human kidney before we can develop the therapies that our patients need. But there's a problem. We rarely biopsy patients with acute tubular injury, and when we do, the limited amount of tissue that remains after clinical tests is not enough to use for discovery purposes using conventional methodologies. Our goal in undertaking this work was to better define many of the cell types that comprise the healthy adult human kidney, including their relative proportions, spatial localization, and the associations between intrinsic renal cells and cells of the immune system. We also wished to develop a framework through which we could perform comparative analysis between normal and diseased human kidney. To accomplish this, we turn towards a novel multiplexing imaging technology called imaging mass cytometry. In conventional immunostaining, a primary antibody is incubated with the tissue of interest and a secondary antibody, conjugated to a fluorophore, is used to detect and visualize the primary antibody. Due to spectral overlap between secondary markers and high endogenous fluorescence in the kidney, there is a limit to how many antibodies can be visualized in concert with one another. In imaging mass cytometry, individual primary antibodies are covalently bonded to rare earth metals and incubated up to 42 at a time on a tissue section. The tissue is then ablated with a laser, with the resulting plume siphoned into a time-of-flight mass spectrometer. This allows us to detect precisely which metals, and therefore which antibodies, were bound to each 1 micron by 1 micron area of tissue. Data can be reconstructed into highly multiplexed images, which can be false-colored and quantitatively analyzed. The advantages of this approach are that you can assess dozens of markers at once without exhausting a scarce tissue sample, and that, because the data are all acquired in a single acquisition, you can readily perform quantitative analysis, as I'll show you. We developed and validated a panel of 23 metal-conjugated markers to interrogate human kidney tissue, including markers to detect nuclei, stromal cells, tubular cells, podocytes, and immune cells. Markers were chosen based on consensus differentially expressed genes from publicly available sequencing data. Here you are seeing adjacent sections from a living donor kidney that was read as histopathologically normal by our renal pathologists. The boxes show regions that we have ablated and imaged with our antibody panel. If we compare IMC reconstructions from just two of those box regions, one in cortex and one in medulla, you can see that we are able to detect nuclei throughout, shown in blue. And we can sequentially layer on pseudocolored data from individual channels. Here I am showing you endothelial cells in red, which in the cortex are most abundant in glomeruli, and in the medulla in vasa and arteriola recta. By showing collagen 4 in yellow, you can appreciate the striking differences in collagen content between cortex and medulla, which are also apparent on the trichrome image shown above. Here I'm adding smooth muscle actin to highlight vasculature, as well as vimentin, which marks stromal cell populations, and WT1 in white, which marks podocytes. Finally, I am showing beta-catenin in green, a marker of tubular epithelium. If we focus solely on the tubules, we can start using our carefully selected antibody panel to determine which tubules are proximal tubules, as marked by dual expression for megalin in cyan and aquaporin 1 in magenta. Note that in the medulla, aquaporin 1 marks the descending limb of the loop of Henle. And now, showing just aquaporin 1 and beta-catenin, we can start determining the identities of other tubular subpopulations, such as the ascending limb of the loop of Henle, defined by uromodulin expression in yellow. Note the thin appearance of the ascending limb in the medulla versus the thick appearance in the cortex. In cyan, I'm now showing the distal convoluted tubule marked by calbindin expression solely in the cortex.
and collecting ducts are defined by cytokeratin 7 expression in white, as well as expression of the principal cell marker aquaporin 2 in blue, seen predominantly in the medulla. We studied several immune cell subpopulations in this work, including macrophages, shown here in red, directly abutting tubules and a glomerulus in the cortex, and throughout the stroma in the medulla. To translate these multiplex 23-channel images into quantitative data, we have developed a machine learning approach based on the work of Bodenmiller and colleagues, which we term kidney maps. We first teach the computer to classify pixels as background, nuclei, tubular cells, endothelial cells, or other cell types, and then to define the borders of each cell. Here's an example of a multiplex image with just 9 of 23 channels shown on a biopsy-sized region from a nephrectomy. Let's focus on the boxed area labeled A. Panel A shows the pseudocolored image reconstruction. Panel B is an example of a single-cell segmentation map that we are able to generate using this approach, applied to this region of interest. We then overlay the raw data from all 23 channels onto the segmentation map using the program Histocat, which is designed for IMC analysis. Histocat clusters cells by their similarity to one another, and a resultant projection is shown in panel C, with each dot in this T-SNE representing a single cell and the colors representing individual cellular phenotypes as defined in the legend. Proximal tubule in blue is the most abundant. Panel D shows that the phenotypes detected in an unsupervised fashion correlate well with those assigned manually by a blinded observer. This was one of several validation experiments that we performed in this work. In order to define the cellular proportions and spatial organization in a representative data set of human kidneys, we obtained tissue from 16 kidneys from 3 independent sources: tumor remote surgical nephrectomy that was obtained both prospectively and retrospectively, as well as living donor tissue. All of this tissue was graded as histopathologically normal by renal pathologists. We were able to quantify the proportions of cells that comprise the normal human cortex and medulla. In the red, I am showing the proportion of several of the more abundant cell types, including proximal tubule, which makes up nearly 40% of the cells in the human cortex and 20% in more superficial regions of the medulla. We applied our kidney maps pipeline to several kidneys with tumor-associated interstitial nephritis and found that, as expected, there was a higher proportion of immune and stromal cells in injury as compared to histopathologically normal nephrectomy and living donor tissue. As well, the number of tubular and endothelial cells, both as a proportion of total cells as well as per square millimeter, decreased in injury. Even in healthy kidneys, there can be a degree of glomerulosclerosis, and in this paper, we sought to characterize the immune interactions with sclerotic glomeruli. We found a T-cell predominant response, and by overlaying IMC images onto adjacent H&E sections, we can even ascribe identities to individual cells, such as the CD4-positive T-cell in the white box and the CD68-positive macrophage in the black box. We also discovered intriguing cell populations in reference kidneys, including a subpopulation of proximal tubular cells, which co-express the intermediate filament protein vimentin. These cells, shown in the black box on the T-SNE and highlighted with the arrowheads in panels B through G, may represent injured or regenerating cells, an area worthy of further exploration. Imaging mass cytometry is a powerful tool for quantitative interrogation of scarce human kidney tissue. We have adapted this technology and an associated machine learning analysis pipeline to develop a quantitative human kidney atlas. We believe that this dataset has great potential utility for informing single-cell and single-nuclear RNA-seq approaches for kidney interrogation. In addition to defining unexpected tubular heterogeneity and rare cell populations, we believe that this work has created the framework for a quantitative interrogation of diseased kidney tissue, work that is currently ongoing in the Cantley Lab. I would like to acknowledge Lloyd Cantley's terrific mentorship, as well as the contributions of members of the Cantley Lab, our collaborators, the Yale CyTOF facility, our funding sources, and the editorial board of JCI Insight for giving us the opportunity to disseminate this work.